First off, if you're someone like me and you've been looking for ways to get better sleep at night, or even naps during the day, make sure to head on down to the link below and check out Manta's fine selection of sleep masks. Don't forget to use promo code ChrisH to get 10% off of your order, and I do receive a small commission from each purchase. We start the video heading east on McNichols, just west of Woodward along the Detroit and Highland Park border. This will be my 18th video in my Detroit series where I go through the entire city. The area that we go through in this video is bounded by Woodward to the west, the enclaves of Highland Park and Hamtramck to the south, Conant to the east, and 8 Mile to the north. Primarily, we'll be going through the 48203 zip code, which is shared with Highland Park. And like a lot of other areas of the city that we've seen at this point, most of this specific area that we're about to go through is abandoned. And in this episode of Why Detroit Has Failed, we'll be talking about how illegal drugs have played a role in the city's overall decline. And really quick, as if you enjoy this video, make sure to drop a like, comment, and subscribe if you haven't already, as doing all of those things helps these videos destroy the evil monster that is the YouTube algorithm. Also, make sure to hit that notification bell and select yes so that you can be notified every time that I upload a new video. If you enjoy this video, then you might enjoy checking out some of the featured playlists on this channel. Videos with amazing insights on other places like what you'll see here can be found in my Detroit playlist, my American Hoods playlist, or in my Michigan playlist. Last but not least, if you can't get enough of me on here, you can always go follow me on my other social media accounts, and those links are below. Currently, we're prowling around the Grixdale Farms neighborhood, home to only just over 1,000 people these days. You can see that the median household income and median value of owner-occupied housing is right on par with the rest of the city, and so are the crime rates. Grixdale Farms is very small and has an older housing stock that's slowly vanishing away as people continue to leave the city. It's a part of the larger 48203 zip code, which is shared with Highland Park to the south, and the zip code, all in all, has 22,000 residents, and the economic stats are even more exaggerated when you factor in the entirety of Highland Park, as that city ranks as the poorest in the nation, with its 9,000 residents. Ironically, one of Detroit's nicest neighborhoods is within this zip code, that being Palmer Woods, and you can expect to see it in my next Detroit video. Currently, we're on Nevada, but we can come back to this street towards the end of the video. Well, at this point, most of us get that Detroit is a massively sized city, and we also understand that most of Detroit has come to look like this, despite the good things happening in downtown, despite the historic neighborhoods that have been preserved in Indian Village, Boston Edison, Palmer Woods. You still have most of the city that looks like this, where you go driving through the residential blocks, or what used to be the residential blocks, and you'll see some remaining buildings and homes here and there within mostly vacant blocks, overgrown vegetation and all. Oh wait, are those flowers? Aw, how pretty. Oh, yeah, well, that was cool. Well, anyway, moving on now. There are many reasons for the abandonment of Detroit, including unemployment, crime, white flight from the 60s and 70s, and political corruption. But in this video, we'll focus on how the illegal drug business has ruined the city. So in the 1980s, much of the nation's inner cities started to see an abundance of crack, and Detroit was one of the hardest hit. With drugs comes the formation of gangs and gang territories as they compete for sales, and with that comes homicides and other forms of violent crime. Yes, gangs, or mobs, or mafias, they've all been around since way before the 80s, but many of the US inner cities saw peaks in violent crime and gang activity during this era. That's right. So with everybody freaking out about the rise in crime today since the pandemic started, they should just look back at what was going on in the 80s and 90s, and they'll realize that today is like heaven compared to then. Anyway, the more people that are involved in the illegal drug business, the more violence it encourages, which in return encourages people who don't wish to be involved in such a lifestyle or surrounded by it to leave for greener pastures.
Drugs are everywhere in the US, and they affect every city. Stop singling out Detroit.
Well, first off, this video is about Detroit, so I'm going to talk about how drugs have affected Detroit, not Oakland, not Baltimore, not Chicago, but Detroit. And yes, drugs are found everywhere these days. Nice suburbs, bad suburbs, nice cities, bad cities, rural cities. You can find hundreds of thousands of meth sheds in rural Missouri, Illinois, Indiana, Michigan, and somewhere in New Mexico. I'm sure Walter White is still working hard at running his empire. But in inner cities such as Detroit, illegal drug usage initially was done at a much higher rate than in other types of communities, and it certainly played a role in Detroit's decline. The reason why there are so many drug dealers throughout Detroit is because the city was made up of a mostly poor, uneducated, and unemployed population, and those factors lead towards encouraging people to make money in other ways, such as by selling drugs. Reasons why the city's population base was that is because of a majority of things, but mainly white flight and because of poor economic decisions made by the city, which encouraged companies and businesses to set up shop in the suburbs, which further declined Detroit's fiscal health and tax base. Anyway, Detroit's crack and cocaine scene peaked around 1984, as the city still had over 1 million people at the time. With that said, in 1987, Detroit's homicide rate saw its peak, and that's not a coincidence, as violent crime and illegal drug activity goes hand in hand. Since many of the homicides in Detroit during that time were not random attacks, and they were between people who knew each other, and rival gang members at that, most of the murders went unsolved, as people were worried about spilling the beans to the cops. As we all know, snitches get stitches, right? Therefore, justice wasn't served on many of the homicides. During that time, police were doing everything that they could to solve these cases as people refused to give out the information that they knew. And that led police to do anything that they could to just come up with a suspect even if it wasn't true. But I mean, from the suspect standpoint, if I knew that I would have a target on my back if I confessed to police, I would be hesitant to give out information as well. Better yet, I would have stayed away from the drug business altogether, but that's a lot easier said than done when you grow up in a neighborhood that's surrounded by gang and drug culture. Sometimes it's the parents at home that are involved, or it's a friend. So yeah, much easier said than done, especially when you're young and naive. Just ask the thousands of people who decided to enter that culture at an early age and have left it in the rearview mirror as they grew older, and hear some of their stories. Anyway, police officers would do things back then, such as lock anyone in a room that they could get their hands on with knowledge of any kind of drug dealer or murder, and they would torture them. Police would threaten quote-unquote snitches by pressuring them to confess to what they know, or what the police thought that they knew, or else they would have you arrested and sent to prison for something that you didn't do. Hence, the beginning of the overall sour relationship between police officers and the predominantly black inner cities. With that said, it's still a problem today, as data shows that of the 60 exonerations that have taken place in the state of Michigan between 1993 and 2015, half of them were in Wayne County, and you can go ahead and assume that most of those were in the city of Detroit. But that's according to this article from The Independent. And if you're unsure of what an exoneration is, it's when someone who has been convicted of a crime has been proven innocent after the arrival of new evidence. But this is what drama, illegal drugs, created in the city. So yes, 1980 to 1990 was a dark decade for Detroit, just like the 90s and 2000s were. In the 80s, Detroit police were under intense pressure to solve the crack epidemic that was ruining the city's quality of life. Another drug that was running rampant throughout the city was heroin. As more young people got their hands on it, more violence occurred as competition increased. Some of the bigger-named gangs during the 70s and 80s in Detroit included the Errol Flynn's, Young Boys Inc., the Chaldean Mafia, and the Black Mafia Family, among many others. Many of the main thoroughfares in Detroit had smaller gangs named after them, such as the Schoolcraft Boys, the Dexter Boys, so on and so on. There were many gangs throughout the city. Let's start by talking about the Errol Flynn's, with the name coming from the Hollywood actor Errol Flynn. The Errol Flynn's were brought up in the 70s while they eventually fell apart in the 80s, but their presence was well known. The Errol Flynn's developed on Detroit's east side and they were one of the first gangs in the country to use gang signs to identify themselves, which was a practice that became adopted by most other gangs as time went on. This group profited off of heroin sales rather than crack, but the members became wealthy during their peak in the late 70s, and they had up to 400 members. More on drug dealers, gangs, mafias, and cartels in a minute, as to the right is where the Michigan State Fairgrounds used to be. The Michigan State Fair was one of the oldest state fairs in the country, with the first one in Detroit being held in 1849. It wasn't until 1904 that the state fair operated within a 164-acre space on Detroit's north side, being bounded by Woodward to the west, 8 Mile to the north, the railroad tracks to the east, and State Fair Avenue to the south. The last state fair held at this location was in 2009. Since then, land has slowly been transferred over to other real estate developers, and on the north side of the property today is a shopping center that has a few big box retailers. Currently, the east side of the property is being developed into an Amazon distribution center, so that's a good thing for the city, as it provides jobs and tax revenue instead of having the old state fairgrounds just be another brownfield. Other projects, such as a transit center, are set to be built on the massive 164-acre site. Unfortunately, with new developments comes the demolition of historic buildings sometimes, such as the Michigan State Fairgrounds Coliseum, which was built in 1922, and this was featured in the comedy movie Semi-Pro, starring Will Ferrell. Back to the drug business. With other rival gangs gaining a presence over time, the Errol Flynn's lost their market share. Heroin started to be a less popular drug as crack became more present. Crack was cheaper, and I guess druggies enjoyed the buzz that they received from crack rather than heroin. Along with that, there was another gang called Young Boys Inc. that took over as the leader in heroin sales in Detroit during the 80s, and that's all she wrote on the Errol Flynn's. Where we are currently is in a place called Chaldean Town, in which calling it a shell of its former self would be a compliment, as it's pretty much completely empty at this point. Being in Chaldean Town brings me to talk about the Chaldean Mafia. But first, a Chaldean identifies as a Middle Easterner who practices either the Christian or Catholic faith, rather than the predominantly Muslim faith that most Middle Easterners practice. Metro Detroit has a higher rate of Middle Eastern immigrants than any other metro area in the U.S., as there are well over 300,000 in southeastern Michigan that have Middle Eastern ancestry. Middle Easterners immigrated to Detroit starting in the 1920s when the automotive jobs were attracting many from across the world. Over time, the Middle Eastern community has spread throughout the suburbs, with the cities of Dearborn and Hamtramck being mostly Middle Eastern. Most other suburbs in the area have a solid Middle Eastern community as well, and today, immigration from that part of the world continues in Metro Detroit because of the strong community that is already in the area. It's important to say that most Chaldeans who have immigrated to the United States are good people, just like most people are of every race or ethnicity. But over time, the Chaldean Mafia was formed in Detroit by a small group of Chaldeans as they found their way into the drug business. The Mafia has connections through Colombia, Tijuana, and other cartels in Mexico. Historically, the Chaldean Mafia would get their drugs through Phoenix and San Diego, while their primary operation was and always has been in Detroit. The Mafia hit its peak in the 80s, and today the Mafia doesn't have near as strong of a presence as the FBI over the years, and other authorities have made up to 111 convictions on members of the Chaldean Mafia. Now, earlier I mentioned Young Boys Inc. and how they took over as one of the leading gangs in Detroit while the Errol Flynns fell apart. Young Boys Inc. had younger youth distribute their heroin throughout the entire city, and they controlled about 80% of the heroin sales in Detroit throughout most of the 80s. These youth were too young for police officers to prosecute if they were caught, as they were minors, and they wouldn't snitch. Their reward? Money. And plenty of it. The gang made up to $50,000 per day during their peak, as they had a second operation in Boston. Over time, Detroit police were able to catch some of the leaders, and the gang fell apart as the leaders and other top members saw long-term prison sentences. Lastly, one of the largest gangs from the 70s and 80s era was the Black Mafia family. This gang started in Detroit and grew to have a presence throughout many inner cities across the nation. The gang received their drugs from various Mexican cartels and distributed their drugs through a partnership with the Crips. The Black Mafia family profited $270 million off of their nationwide operation, but they were found in Atlanta as the leaders, along with 150 other members, received long-term prison sentences. I only mentioned the well-known gangs of the time, as there were dozens of other smaller ones throughout the city, maybe even hundreds, but you can only imagine how many gang wars took place and how many shootings were related to gang activity over that time stretch in the 80s. Once again, all of this plays a role into why Detroit looks the way that it does today throughout most of its residential areas.
Who is this guy? Not everybody who lives here is a criminal. Stop making us sound like something that we're not.
I never said that everyone that lived here was a criminal. Once again, what I'm doing is explaining how illegal drugs have played a role in ruining the residential areas of Detroit. And you can't deny the abandonment, vacancy, and urban decay that you see throughout the city limits. Today, gangs are still present in Detroit, as most of us know, although they're not as strong as they were in the 70s and 80s. Today, a lot of gang members will make posts on social media of their organized crime, and that helps police find and stop them. There's also way less people in Detroit today than there were in the 70s and 80s, so the declining customer base also plays a role into how gang and violent crime activity hit their peak 40 years ago in Detroit. The result of those rough years is what we see here: abandonment, urban blight, and decay throughout much of the city's residential areas. And don't kid yourself, as Detroit is still considered to be one of the most dangerous cities in the country. St. Louis has taken the role as the nation's leading murder city out of the large US cities, but Detroit is a close second. Meanwhile, this particular street doesn't look too bad, as most of the houses are still standing and appear to be occupied. Now we're heading south onto Quinder from 8 Mile, but one other story that I can share is one that is pretty well known, and that's the story of White Boy Rick, as it goes hand in hand with what I've been talking about in this video. White Boy Rick, otherwise known as Rick Wershey Jr., found himself entering the illegal drug business in Detroit back in the 1980s. There was even a Netflix documentary that came out in 2017 called White Boy that illustrated his life quite well. To put it briefly, White Boy Rick grew up in a blue-collar family on the east side of Detroit when the city was at its height of violent crime and gang activity. Rick's father was an illegal weapons dealer, and the story has it that Rick was pressured into being a snitch on drug dealers to protect his dad from going to jail, who ended up going to jail anyway for 7.5 years. Anyway, Rick provided information to the FBI out of being pressured, and he would often visit the homes of some of the more well-known drug dealers, most notably the Curry brothers. One of them, Johnny Curry, was engaged to then-Detroit Mayor Coleman Young's niece. At the age of 14, Rick was the youngest FBI informant, and he was one of, if not the biggest, sources of information for the feds during this time as they tried to find where the drugs were coming from in Detroit. The FBI recorded the tips that Rick gave them under his father's name so that they didn't have an underage informant on record. And they taught Rick how to deal drugs, and they made him get involved with some of Detroit's most dangerous gangs. Over time, as Rick's investigation skills improved with experience, he began to see corruption within Detroit's police department. This story involves a 13-year-old boy who was shot by the Curry gang over a drug and money dispute. Rick saw that the Detroit police knew what happened and did nothing about it. The chief homicide inspector for Detroit police at the time, Gilbert Hill, diverted the investigation away from the gang leader, Johnny Curry, who, once again, was engaged to then-Mayor Coleman Young's niece, and Rick was able to catch on to that pretty quickly. Johnny Curry was considered to be the king of Detroit crime during those days, but his connection to the mayor's niece mostly kept him out of the legal system at the time. Rick found out that Curry had given Hill a $10,000 bribe to keep his name out of the investigation. And despite Rick finding out this information, Mayor Young and his inspector, Hill, would walk away free from corruption charges. An anonymous FBI agent says that the agency was ordered to let them go, and the reason being that the nation didn't want to add any more negative news headlines over mayors of major cities being corrupt, as then Washington, D.C. Mayor Marion Barry was caught dealing crack. The FBI was also worried about the discovery of their underage informant in Rick, and soon the FBI let him go. At this point, Rick was known as a snitch, and he knew that he had a hit out on him, so he was forced to find a way to survive without witness protection. Years after the incident, information came out that Hill had ordered a hit on Rick because he knew too much. Apparently, Hill went to a hitman in Nate Boone Craft, who had 30 confirmed murders. That was said by Kraft himself in an interview later on, and he added that he was offered $125,000 from Hill if Rick was killed. Anyway, Rick was able to survive the hit on him, even though a Curry gang member shot him. Rick didn't have any other way to provide for himself during this time, so he ended up selling drugs, as that's the best way that he knew how to make money, as the FBI taught him well. He became well known and became pretty successful at dealing drugs. Curry was in jail off of Rick's information, and Rick had taken a good portion of Curry's market share. He also took Curry's girl in Mayor Coleman Young's niece. Meanwhile, it's yet again another abandoned school. Mm-hmm. Well, Rick's glory days as a drug dealer didn't last very long, as it was only just a couple of days before his 18th birthday when Detroit police knocked on his door and caught him with 17 pounds of crack. Immediately, news stories broke out of Rick being the biggest drug dealer in Detroit, even though it wasn't true. The Detroit police told the media outlets that Rick was on top of the ladder of the illegal drug business in Detroit. It was true to an extent that Rick was involved in the illegal drug business, but not quite to the extent that Detroit police had made it out to be. And it was clear that the Detroit police wanted Rick because of the information that he knew of them while being an underage FBI informant. During his trial, the judge said that Rick was worse than a mass murderer. His dad tried to get the FBI to help, but they wouldn't do anything because they didn't want to get caught for using an underage FBI informant. And so, in return, Rick was sentenced to life in prison at 18 years old. Despite originally being sentenced to life, Rick was able to leave confinement after 32 years. During his time, Rick was involved in a 2008 car theft ring from behind bars, but in July of 2020, Rick Wershey Jr. was finally released from prison after serving 30 years for his drug offenses in Michigan when he was a teenager, and an extra 2 years for his involvement in the Florida car theft ring. Anyway, that's just one example of how someone who grows up in a family of chaos or in a chaotic neighborhood can get involved in a gang or in the illegal drug business without any other options, as his dad was selling weapons illegally and his entire neighborhood was affected by the war on crack. What's really messed up is that Rick spent more time in prison than most of the people that he was pressured to snitch on by the FBI. Well, if we were to continue going straight on this thoroughfare, we would be in Hamtramck, and you can check out a video on Hamtramck by looking through my Detroit playlist. Throughout the rest of this video, I'll be driving on some of the other thoroughfares through the section of the city that I have drawn out for this video, as the whole point of this series, people, is to see the entire city and learn about it. And as we head north on Woodward, I do end the video here. If you enjoyed this video, make sure to drop a like, comment, and subscribe if you haven't already, as doing all of those things helps these videos destroy the evil monster that is the YouTube algorithm. Also, make sure to hit that notification bell and select yes so that you can be notified every time that I upload a new video. If you enjoyed this video, then you might enjoy checking out some of the featured playlists on this channel. Videos with amazing insights on other places like what you saw here can be found in my Detroit playlist, my American Hoods playlist, or in my Michigan playlist. Last but not least, if you can't get enough of me on here, you can always go follow me on my other social media accounts, and those links are below. We'll see you next time. Peace!